Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another brand new episode of the Word of the Day podcast. My name is Jimmy Silva. I am your host, and I am very pleased to welcome back to the program for her second appearance, my friend and fellow language enthusiast, Kaylin. Kaylin, thanks so much for being here again.
Thank you for having me, Jamie.
Now, folks, today's episode is going to be a little different from normal, because instead of pleasantly explaining a useful word, we're going to explore a linguistic theme that touches on actually quite a few words. And that theme is how there are lots of simple words that people say all the time that are short for very long words that people don't say all that often and may not even know about. In linguistic circles, these short versions of long words are called clipped words. And as I was exploring the concept, a couple of these turned out to be pretty fun and interesting and worth spending a bit more time on. So I just named the episode after them.
To get started, let's run through some basic clipped words that you probably do know about. For example, the word memo, as in did you miss the memo, is short for memorandum. Condo is short for condominium, gym for gymnasium, vet for veterinarian or veteran, fridge for refrigerator, limo for limousine, math for mathematics, and rehab is short for a rehabilitation center where addicts might go to try and recover.
Okay, very good. My turn. There's lab for laboratory, exam for examination, ref for referee, pro for professional, ad for advertisement, hippo for hippopotamus, mic for microphone, grad for graduate, and dorm for dormitory.
And there are lots more. Keep an eye out and you'll see them everywhere. Now, the point here isn't to say that you should start using the long versions. Like, you can if you want, but in ordinary conversation, the abbreviated forms will do just fine and are often preferable because they're less fancy and rhetorically ostentatious.
What we're more interested in are the longer versions of words that are rather off the beaten path, such that there's a good chance you've only heard of the short versions.
First up, we have a tarp, as in a large waterproof sheet. That is short for tarpaulin, or if you're in the UK, tarpaulin.
Next, if you send a fax, you're technically sending a facsimile. That is the full word. Facsimile is also its own word, separate from a sheet of paper sent electronically from one facsimile machine to another. Google defines this form of facsimile as, quote, an exact copy, especially of written or printed material, unquote. Yeah, so paper, of course, but also other identical things, too, could be facsimiles, like peas in a pod, paintings of the same bowl of fruit, or I suppose even twins, if they're identical, could be said to be facsimiles of each other.
Up next, we have the word recap, which is short for recapitulation, or in the verb form, recapitulate, which refers to the act of recapping or summarizing something.
For this one, I like to think of like sports TV shows that might show a collection of highlights from a game, which the hosts will refer to as the game recap. Well, imagine if, instead of that, they said, and now let's turn it over to Dan, who will recapitulate the Yankees-Red Sox game for us. Dan? And then Dan would be like, thank you, Steve. Okay, let's take a look at the game recapitulation highlights. This would be so much clunkier, of course, but it's exactly the same idea. And so, in a sense, they're already saying that, just shorter. Okay, Kaylin, what else we got?
Well, if you stop by a local deli for a sandwich, that's actually a delicatessen. If spelt with a K instead of a C, this is just a German word meaning delicacies or fine foods. Delicatesse would be the singular.
Next, if you're reading something and you find, say, a misspelled word, you might say, aha, a typo. Or you could be fancy and say, aha, a typographical error.
Now, we had thought that harp was short for harpsichord, but it turns out that those are different instruments, as the harpsichord is basically a piano, and a harp is, well, a harp. But speaking of pianos, the word piano is short for pianoforte, also known apparently as a forte piano. The name was bestowed on the instrument by the person commonly credited with inventing it in the late 17th century, one Bartolomeo Cristofori. He described the new instrument as a grav'incembalo col piano e forte, which is Italian for a harpsichord with soft and loud, with soft meaning the equivalent of quiet. So I guess a pianoforte is literally a soft loud, and a piano is just a soft or a quiet.
Weird. So if you're playing the piano, then that means you could say you're playing the quiet?
If you're playing in Italian.
By this standard, things like tubas and bagpipes should be called forte fortes, because they're nearly impossible to play quietly. Or at least, no one ever does. Now, the next term is a con man, also known as a con artist. This is short for a confidence man, so called because he wins your confidence, tricks you into giving him money, and then finally, skedaddles. and we actually know the precise origin of this term. It comes from a newspaper account in the New York Herald in 1849 concerning the arrest of a very brazen swindler. To quote, lightly edited for clarity, "For the last few months, a man has been traveling about the city known as the Confidence Man. He would go up to a perfect stranger in the street, and, being a man of genteel appearance, which is to say, refined and respectable-looking, he would easily command their attention. After some little conversation, he would ask, 'Have you confidence in me to trust me with your watch until tomorrow?'"
At this novel request, the stranger, supposing him to be some old acquaintance not at that moment recollected, allows him to take the watch, thus placing quote-unquote confidence in the honesty of the stranger, who walks off laughing, and the other, supposing it to be a joke, allows him to do so. In this way, many have been duped, unquote.
I gotta say, that's not a very elaborate trick, and I sure don't think I'd just hand over my valuables to someone I don't even know just because they asked to borrow them for a day.
I mean, no one ever thinks they'll get taken in by a con artist, Jamie. That's why they're able to fool so many people. Also, unrelatedly, can I borrow your microphone?
Absolutely not.
Shucks. Well, it was worth a shot.
Was it, though? Like I said, Caitlin, I'm very hard to fool. Okay, up next we have prom, as in high school prom. This is the first of the two words that we're going to spend a bit more time on here. Prom is a shortening of the word promenade, or as the Brits would have it, promenade. Although I think this British version is pretty common on this side of the pond as well, such that you can say either one and sound normal. And actually, I kind of prefer promenade myself.
As do I. Now, this word has a few different definitions, all of which are interesting. First up is the verb form of promenade, which Google defines as, quote, "to take a leisurely public walk, ride, or drive so as to meet or be seen by others," unquote. This word comes from the French promener, meaning to walk.
And speaking of walks, if I might go on a brief baseball tangent here. So a walk, which is when a pitcher throws four balls and the batter gets to go to first, in baseball slang can be called a promenade.
Interesting. Now, back to the Google definition. Notice that a promenade isn't just any walk. Rather, it is leisurely, out in a public place, and probably conducted with the express purpose of being seen by others.
Yeah, I'm not positive whether the purpose of your promenading would be to attract suitors, anger rivals, or just let people know that you're out there living your best life and having a great time. But in any case, that is what it means to promenade. And since the Google definition mentions driving or riding as well, I suppose if you wanted to show off your fancy new car, or bike, or horse, and you drove slash rode it around town so that everyone could stare and gape and envy you, then that would also count as a promenade.
Next, the noun form of promenade means, quote, "a paved public walk, typically one along a waterfront at a resort," unquote. Well, this makes sense. Like, what better place to promenade to be seen by your peers than on a literal promenade?
Totally. But I wouldn't get too hung up on the waterfront at a resort setting. Any other reasonably public thoroughfare or walkway that is particularly designed for leisurely strolling and can be seen from a good distance around, I think can qualify as a promenade. So, like a boardwalk, a pedestrian bridge, a wide path around a lake, etc.
For example, here's how the word appears in the song "Jenny Was a Friend of Mine" by the band The Killers. That lyric, once again, is "we had a fight out on the promenade," which we can presume, based on the word's meaning, is probably out in public in full view of many bystanders.
Wow, yeah, that's extra confrontational, extra dramatic. Notice, by the way, that although The Killers are an American band, they say the word as promenade, the ostensibly British pronunciation, again illustrating the fact that either pronunciation is acceptable in American speech. Conversely, in this next song, Atlantic City, performed by the band, The Band, that's like what this band is called, we hear the word pronounced as promenade.
Down on the boardwalk, they're ready for a fight. Gonna see what them racket boys can do. Now there's trouble bussing in from out of state, and the DA can't get no relief. Gonna be a rumble on a promenade, and the gambling commissioner's hanging on.
A rumble out on the promenade. Wow, once again, this sounds like some serious mischief.
Yeah, whatever. Now, let's delve into this word's meaning a little further. Another, more obscure definition from Merriam-Webster goes like this. Quote, a ceremonious opening of a formal ball consisting of a grand march of all the guests, unquote. Okay, so I feel like anyone who has seen a British period drama can picture what this looks like, when all the fine ladies and gentlemen are entering the grand ballroom and possibly being announced by a master of ceremonies as they do so.
Yeah, I remember this. And like, as they walk in, the MC person will be like, the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge, followed by Prince Fitzwilliam and Lady Beatrice, etc. It's not like everyone got their own walk-up music or did a little dance like they're couples in a wedding party, but I like to imagine that they did. Especially since a promenade is also sort of a step or series of steps in a ton of different dance styles. Swing, tango, foxtrot, country, and several others. So it would make sense for that to be the little mini-dance that couples would enter a ballroom to.
Now, if you put all these promenade ideas together, they start looking a lot like a high school prom. Prom being the clipped version of promenade.
There's dancing at a prom, right? And there's this sense of being out in public and presenting yourself to society. And depending on the sort of dancing involved, you might even find yourself promenading at your high school promenade / promenade.
Okay, the last example we're going to feature today of a clipped word is the noun perk. You all know what a perk is, right? It's like a benefit you get by being part of a particular group or club, organization, or company.
So, for example, the perks of being on the board of directors at your local library might include no late fees, permission to build little forts and tunnels in the aisles made out of books, and reserving a space on the new and recommended shelf for your self-published history of pickles.
As many of you likely know, most companies like to talk about the great perks they offer to their employees, like free snacks, maybe an on-site gym, and your choice of roller skates, a skateboard, a unicycle, or a pogo stick in order to get around the office faster.
Well, perk, as it turns out, is short for the word perquisite. The meaning is, of course, the same. It's the opposite of another little-known word, requisite, which refers to things that are required of you. In turn, perquisite refers to things that are given to you, that you get, usually just because you're part of an organization or group, but also more generally. Like, you could say that getting a tan is one of the many perks/perquisites of being outside in the sun regularly.
The etymology of perquisite is pretty fun. This word first popped up in English in the mid-15th century, meaning property acquired other than by inheritance. So rather than meaning like an extra bonus or additional benefit, perquisite referred to anything you bought or made yourself. Unless someone bequeathed or passed it down to you upon their death, most everything you owned was a perquisite.
As is so often the case, there's a Latin word that adds further context here. In medieval Latin, the word perquisitum meant profit, or something gained.
I think it's really intriguing that although both the root words and perquisite itself have to do with property, the way you get that property has kind of reversed. The modern sense of perquisite is like stuff that you didn't earn, but were just given above and beyond your wages.
And this is how, in particular, a lot of companies will frame the perks they offer. They're like, hey, we as a firm are so generous, and we care about you employees so much, that we're not just going to compensate you with like a salary or an hourly wage. How stingy would that be? Instead, we'll top off your compensation with a whole bunch of fabulous perks. And, you know, look, these may be nice perks and all, and you probably wouldn't turn them down, but a cynic might argue that perks are just another form of compensation, and a less efficient one at that, because if a company just gave their employees the money that it was spending on, you know, for example, free kombucha on tap, the employees could then make their own decisions about what they would want to buy with that money. Maybe the company guessed right, and fresh kombucha at the office was at the top of everybody's list of things they wanted in their lives, but maybe not.
The point is, businesses, at least rhetorically, tend to treat workplace perks almost as if they're gifts, freebies that aren't earned by the employees, but rather given out by the company, just to be nice. This is basically the opposite of the original 15th century meaning of perquisite, which, again, referred only to things you earned or made yourself. Freebies, particularly inheritance, didn't count. But if you think of employee perks as what they actually are, i.e. methods of boosting your productivity or incentives to keep you around, essentially compensation, then you understand that they're not just gifts and you actually do earn them. So from your perspective, they're perquisites in the original sense, even though nowadays they're perquisites in the modern sense. Once again, it all fits together.
It sure does. And I don't think that was an overly complicated idea to include in a podcast at all. Okay, there may be more of these common short words that have long and little known or little used equivalents, so if you think of some I missed or some you like to use, feel free to email them to us at wotdpodcast@gmail.com, that is WOTD as in word of the day, or maybe share them on our Facebook page. Well, folks, I think that will about do it for us, and that'll do it for today's show. I want to thank you all very much for tuning in, and thank you so much, Kaylin, for joining me.
Thank you for having me, Jamie.
And folks, be sure to follow her linguistics and photography Instagram at travel_linguist, whose followers we consulted for examples of clipped words to use in this episode. So thanks so much to all those who contributed. And normally, of course, this is something that our large in-house research team would handle, but we were glad for the assistance anyway. Oh, and one other thing before we go. At the end of the last episode, I mentioned that I had left my former job in the financial industry, and I'm trying to start up my own business as a voiceover and public speaking coach. Well, I am happy to report that since that episode aired, I've gone from, I think, 2 or 3 clients to 20. Space in my schedule is filling rather faster than I anticipated. So if you want to join in this apparently hot trend of hiring me as a vocal/speaking coach, I've put a link in the show notes to my little freelancer profile on thumbtack.com, which is where I conduct this business. And if you're curious what you could expect from me as a coach, either in terms of process or results, look no further than the guests on this very show. Because, you see, every talented voice actor you hear goes through several hours of coaching and practice along the path to a finished episode. And for a little peek behind the scenes, Kaylin has graciously agreed to let me include some outtakes, some bloopers, at the end of today's program, if you listen past the music. They are worth a chuckle, I think. Alrighty then, this has been another edition of the Word of the Day podcast, where useful words are pleasantly explained. My name is Jamie Silva, your host, saying so long, thank you for listening, and as always, have a great day.
Another more obscure definition from the Merriam-Webster goes like this.
Sorry, from the Merriam-Webster. Also, you're saying Merriam. It's Merriam.
Oh, I've always said Merriam.
Yeah, Webster. That would be for M-I-R-R-I-A-M.
Yeah, that's true. Merriam.
Merriam-Webster. It rhymes with, if you like it so much, why don't you marry it?
Well, I would, but he doesn't want to marry me. That is short for tarpaulin.
Nope. That is short for tarpaulin.
Tarpaulin. That is short for tarpaulin.
Nope. That is short for tarpaulin. Look, you clear your throat as much as you need. I need like a lozenge.
A what?
A lozenge. Lozenge? Lozenges. Lozenge.
I don't know what that is.
It's like a little cough drop.
Why wouldn't you just say cough drop?
I can say lozenge. We also have some sweetmeats in the kitchen, if you would like. Have you ever heard those?
Sweetmeats?
It's one word.
Sweetmeats.
Yes, it just means candy.
I don't like that term. Sweetmeats? Why would you call candy
don't
a sweet
don't emphasize meat? The meats. They're sweetmeats. What I'm saying is people who had lozenges would probably have also had sweetmeats.
Okay.
All right. I also would never say that elsewhere. I'd be much more willing to say foodstuffs.
Foodstuffs?
I had an episode on this, Kaylin. Clearly you don't listen.
I listened to all the ones that you sent me. Oh, now I have to say interesting again. Interesting?
How would you go with scintillating?
Scintillating? No, thanks.
Fascinating.
Fascinating.
All but darned. No, you can just say interesting.
Unless someone bequeathed or passed it down to you
Bequeathed.
Bequeathed. Okay. Unless someone...
Bequeathed.
Most everything you owned was a perquisite.
Great job. Now you get to do it again.
Oh.
That was take one.
I think that was a good take.
But it's a 2-take minimum. Unless you're me, of course.
Dang it. Yeah, you're always the exception.
It sure does, Kaylin. And I don't think that was an overly... Weird. What? Why?
Sorry.
Why? What?
You were stumbling too much and that sounded too fake.
What if some of the stumbling was on purpose? No, okay, fine. And Dan would be like, thank you, Steve. Okay, let's take a look at the game... Let's take a look at the game recapitulation highlights.
That's a hard word.
Oh, I'm also saying game recapitulation. I can't.
My pleasure, Jamie.
Sounded very unenthused. sound actually.
It's not actually my pleasure, Jamie.
Keeping that.